evening, everybody. My name's Caleb Click. I'm the pastor to youth here at First Pres. We're so glad you're here with us this evening. I've just got a couple quick announcements. First, if you missed it this morning and you have a child that's here, we have now considered them promoted. So they're now officially a year older than they were when the summer ended. And for some of you, that may mean that you have kids in the youth ministry, which means they're now between 6th and 12th grade. And if that's the case, we're super excited to have them. I can't wait to get to know them a little better, but those things, all the youth activities, they're on hold for the next couple weeks until August 25th, which is our Upper Bound kickoff, and August 27th, which is our High Life kickoff. And once those things started, we'll be rolling, but until that time, we're just letting the school year pick up. And one last announcement before I forget, there is a new Sunday school for young professionals. This is for those of you in your 20s and your 30s. It started this morning, but I'm sure that if you wanted to join in now, they would gladly accept you. So let me pray for us, and we'll get started. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful that when we come to you, we come to a God who has no illusions about who we are. Lord, you see through the facade, you see through the masks, you see through the smiles and the clothes, you see everything about us, Lord, the deepest, darkest parts of our hearts. And Lord, there is no hiding from you where many of us are today. That, Lord, some of us have come in here struggling with sin. Others have come struggling with strife in their marriage, in their family, with their kids, with their parents. Some of us, Lord, we are desperate to know you, and we don't. And so, Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit would draw our hearts this evening, that you would speak to us through worship and the word, that you would take us into your presence, and that you would bring us into the only pasture that could ever satisfy our souls, the one that your Son, Jesus Christ, governs, who is the gate for his sheep. Bring us there today, in Jesus' name, amen.
Good evening. Would you please stand? And we'll sing through this the first time for you so you can get an idea of what's going on with it. And the second time through, we ask that you join in with us. Have a seat. How many of you know that God is good? And His mercies endure forever. Please stand and join us, please. Hallelujah.
singing. First Pres, thank you for the gospel choir under the joint direction of Henry Johnson from Corinth Church. And we also welcome the New Life Ministries Church, pastored by Pastor Hector Caceres. We welcome you and your congregation this evening. And Pastor Hector's interpreter could not make it tonight. And so Miss Leah Bergano has gotten the gift of tongues tonight. I tapped her on the shoulder.
All right.
And thank you for responding so quickly.
It's a pleasure.
We are honored to have you tonight. And would you tell us the vision for your church, New Life Ministries?
Alguien me dijo en cierta ocasión.
Somebody told me on some occasion.
Que los hispanos somos ahora la minoría mayor en los Estados Unidos.
That Hispanics are now the largest minority in the United States.
So, tenemos en nuestro corazón.
We have in our hearts.
Llegar a todos los hispanos posibles.
To reach as many Hispanics as possible.
Con el Evangelio de Jesucristo.
With Jesus Christ.
Nuestra gente hispana necesita a Cristo.
Our Hispanic people need Christ.
Y creo que Dios nos puso aquí con ese propósito.
And I believe that God has placed us here with that very purpose.
Amen.
Amen.
You became a pastor in a roundabout way. You went to seminary in the U.S. Army. Is that right? Would you tell us how did you become a pastor?
Estuve en el Army 20 años y una semana.
I was in the Army 20 years and 1 week.
Para asegurarme.
To make sure.
Okay. Y estando en la capellanía,
I was a chaplain.
El Army nos llevó a diferentes lugares.
The Army took us different places.
Y la nube de Jehová,
and the cloud of Jesus of Jehovah,
se detuvo en Augusta, Georgia.
Stopped in Augusta, Georgia.
Y donde Dios se detuvo,
and where God stopped,
también nos detuvimos nosotros.
So we had to stop too.
Y en el año 2002,
in the year 2002,
el Señor nos dio el honor.
God gave us, the Lord gave us the honor.
To comenzar el ministerio Nueva Vida.
Of beginning the ministry of New Life.
Una extraordinaria aventura con Dios.
An extraordinary adventure with our Lord.
Amen.
We have worshiped together on three occasions now at the Martin Luther King observance and Beulah Grove Baptist Church, the National Day of Prayer, and tonight. Why is it important that we worship together, Pastor Hector?
Creo que la respuesta a esa pregunta,
the answer to that question,
la encontramos en Juan 17.
We'll find in John 17.
En la oración de Jesús.
In the Lord's Prayer, Jesus' Prayer.
Donde él oró.
Where he prayed.
Por la unidad de su pueblo.
For the unity of his people, his town, his
country. Nosotros creemos en la unidad del cuerpo de Cristo.
We believe in the unity of the body of Christ.
En promover lo que Jesús oró.
In promoting and advancing what he asked for, what he prayed for.
Porque estoy convencido.
Because I am convinced.
Que Dios puso en nuestras manos.
That God has placed in our hands.
Como iglesia.
As a church.
El hacer realidad la respuesta a esa oración.
To make a reality the answer to that prayer.
Creemos en la unidad del cuerpo de Cristo.
We believe in the unity of the body of Christ.
Porque esa fue la petición de Jesús.
Because that was what Jesus asked for.
Amen.
Amen.
How can we pray for your ministry at New Life?
Amen. Nuestra visión.
Our vision.
Es construir un templo.
Is to build a temple.
Para 450 personas.
For 450 people.
Actualmente tenemos más de 200 personas.
At the moment we have about 200 people.
De 11 diferentes países.
From 11 different countries.
Ya el Señor nos facilitó el terreno.
The Lord has already provided us the land.
4 acres and a half.
4.5 acres.
En Deansbridge.
In Deansbridge.
Ahora necesitamos los 3.5 million.
Now we need the 3.5 million
para construir el templo.
To build the temple.
El Señor nos ha demostrado,
and God has shown us,
que Él es un Dios de milagros.
Oh, He is a God of miracles.
Y como ya hizo provisión para el terreno,
and since He has already provided the land,
yo creo,
I believe,
yo creo,
I believe,
yo creo,
I believe,
que Él va a hacer provisión para el templo.
That He will provide for the temple.
Oren por esa petición.
He wants us to pray for that.
Amen.
We will pray for that. Amen. Would you please introduce your wife to us and have your congregation stand that we might recognize them?
Por favor, pónganse en pie los de Nueva Vida. Please stand. Me acompaña mi esposa Kathy.
My wife Kathy.
Mi amiga.
My friend.
Mi esposa.
My wife.
Mi compañera ministerial.
My partner in ministry.
Por más de 35 años.
For 35 years.
Doy gracias a Dios por eso.
I thank God for that.
Thank you, Pastor Hector. Thank you, Leah, for being so helpful. Would you please rise? Let's pray together, and ushers, please come forward. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have made it possible for us to get a taste of heaven before we get there. As we worship together from different countries, different ethnicities, we worship the same Christ, saved in the same way. We come to the same Lord's table to eat and drink together, and as Pastor Hector has said, to realize the answer to your prayer to the Father, that they would be one as you and the Father are one. We ask, O Lord, that by these kinds of worship services and partnerships in ministry, that we would demonstrate to the world the reconciling power of the gospel, that they would recognize that it alone is powerful enough to break down dividing walls of hostility. Thank you for the work of this gospel choir, for the vision of Henry Johnson and Paul Roberts in putting it together, for the participation of Corinth Baptist Church and New Life Ministries and First Presbyterian. And we pray for others to join eventually too, that it might not just be a diversity of ethnicities and races, but also a diversity of churches that all uphold the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray this evening in particular for these members of the Pleasant Home Parish and ask that you would not only bless them individually and as families, but would you bless them missionally in their neighborhoods, that they would advance the gospel this week in the place where they live, the places where they work. We pray it for Beth and Mike Cave and Helen, Catherine, Annie, Allie, Stephen, and Lizzie, for Shirley and Jim Coleman, for Juliana, Elijah, Isabel, Abram, and Sophia. Thank you, Lord, for Jamie and Tony Dorenzo, and we pray for Drew and Mason and Samantha, for Jeannie and Billy English, for Jess and Drew Epting, along with Jane and Evelyn, for Cheryl and St. Paul Gaffney, along with Nathan, Isaac, and Justin. We pray that you would knit us together as a church of the Lord Jesus Christ, that your work might be advanced and you might get a name for yourself. Do it through these gifts as well, we pray. We don't forget to pray as well for the provision financially, for the church building, for New Life Ministries. We've been studying Haggai and how important it is for the gathered church to have a place that is called a local church in their neighborhood, an outpost of the original temple, a demonstration of the promise of Jesus Christ to be with us to the end of the age. So would you also demonstrate yourself to be the Lord Almighty, the one who not only gave them the land, but the one who made them a generous people to raise up an edifice that would be called the church house, their temple. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Master's hand lifts you up every morning. The Master's hand gives you comfort in the night. Sinner man, won't you give your heart to Jesus? Place your head.
Please stand.
Pastor Hector and your congregation, I would like to preach tonight in Spanish. But in order for that to happen, we might have to have a second Pentecost. But I can say this, mi casa, su casa. If you would turn in your Bibles to Luke chapter 7. We're continuing our series on the parables of Jesus. And we have a little short parable that we're going to look at tonight in the context of a larger story. So this parable is sandwiched in between a story that Jesus is telling through the writing of Luke that I think can be a great challenge and encouragement to us tonight. Recently at a party in Charleston, South Carolina, actor and comedian Bill Murray made an appearance at this wedding party and offered his best suggestion, his life lessons, and his tips to the groom. Now, I read those lessons that he offered, and I'm not going to share them with you tonight. Suffice it to say, they were devoid of much spirituality. Opposed and opposite to that, we were able to attend last night over on Green Street a wedding of Paige Busby and Zach Heron, CO folks from Aiken, who hopefully will be going to Manila sometime next year. And in that service, we did hear the kinds of lessons that we need to hear about marriage and what it means to be in a marriage. But I was just thinking to myself, what possible example could I use that would be like the parable that Jesus gives to us and the story that Luke tells us? And I thought, well, it might be like Bill Murray, because he seems to have this habit now in his life of showing up in these inopportune times, in these inopportune places, and just inserting himself into whatever the event is, whether it's a wedding or a photo shoot of models or just walking down the street. He decides he just wants to enter into whatever you're talking about. And I thought to myself, that is somewhat like this parable in the sense that it's unusual, it's unpredictable, you don't know how to explain it, you can't explain it, but it just happens. And Jesus is going to use that kind of story tonight to tell us a little bit about his love and a little bit about the ways that we can receive that love through forgiveness. Luke chapter 7, beginning in verse 36. One of the Pharisees asked him to eat with him, and he went into the Pharisee's house and took his place at the table. And behold, a woman of the city who was a sinner, when she learned that he was reclining at table in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster flask of ointment. And standing behind him at his feet, weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair, the hair of her head, and kissed his feet and anointed them with the ointment. Now when the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would have known who and what sort of woman this is who is touching him, for she is a sinner." And Jesus answering said to him, "Simon, I have something to say to you." And he answered, "Say it, teacher." "A certain money lender had two debtors, one owed 500 denarii and the other 50. When they could not pay, he canceled the debt of both. Now, which of them loved him more?" Simon answered, "The one, I suppose, for whom he canceled the larger debt." And he said to him, "You have judged rightly." Then turning toward the woman, he said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but from the time I came in, she has not ceased to kiss my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she has anointed my feet with ointment. Therefore, I tell you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But he who is forgiven little loves little." And he said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." Then those who were at a table with him began to say among themselves, "Who is this who even forgives sins?" And he said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word, and we thank you in particular tonight for this passage. Would you open our hearts to receive the deep, penetrating truth of this story? Would you open our ears that we might hear it afresh tonight to your honor and glory and to our great blessing? We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So as I said, tonight's parable is really a story within a story. It's Luke teaching us about faith. He's teaching us about love. He's teaching us about compassion. He's teaching us about the love of a son, the love of a father through his son. Simon, a Pharisee, has asked Jesus to dine with him. There's a book I've been reading recently, and it's called Eating Your Way Through Luke's Gospel. And it's a wonderful book about all of the occasions in the Gospel of Luke that have to do with Jesus eating meals. He loved to eat, so he's right at home with us. And amazing things happen around the table, and it certainly does in this case tonight. So Simon, a Pharisee, has asked Jesus to dine with him. And it might be what was called in the ancient Near East a symposium, where they would come together for a meal, they'd gather around and they'd talk philosophical issues, civil issues, spiritual or religious issues, and they'd just have a great conversation about that. So it's quite possible that that's the kind of meal that Simon has, and he's asking Jesus to come, and we're not exactly sure why he wants Jesus to come. He's inquisitive, no doubt, but the text doesn't really say, well, he's trying to trap Jesus, or he just wants to get to know him better. He doesn't really say, but he learns probably a lot more than he wants to learn by the end of this episode and this meal that he has with Jesus. Obviously, he had questions for him, but all of that, all the questions he may have had, take a back seat to what's about to happen in this story. Now, you really can't get the sense of it in the NIV or the ESV in the second verse where it says, "Behold, a woman of the city." to understand exactly what Luke is trying to say in that passage, you have to almost hear it as, oh no! Look who's come. Look who's entering into my house. I can't believe this is happening. That's what Luke wants us to feel. And behold just doesn't quite get us there. So here's how this can happen. You're probably thinking, well, how does this woman even gain access into this man's house? I mean, don't they drive in and open up the garage door and pull their car in and close it down and don't see anybody until the next day when they leave again? Well, not so in many of those cities and villages. They had almost a courtyard in their house, and these meals would take place in this courtyard. It would be relatively open to the outside, and oftentimes people, passerbyers, maybe poor people who were hoping to scrounge up some leftovers, would just hang around and they would listen to what was going on. So it's quite possible that that's what's going on and that this woman has easy access to Simon's dinner party and she has easy access to Jesus. So this is what happens. She comes in and she makes a scene. She not only stops the story, she steals the show. Nothing else really matters after she enters the room. Whatever questions Simon may have had, they're gone. They're out the window at this point. This is no ordinary home. This is the home of a Pharisee. And you probably are well aware that Pharisees had these strict rules for purity. There was something about the Pharisees that saw themselves as different than the outsiders. And they wanted to keep the distance from outsiders. So just the fact that this woman would enter Simon's house is distressing and disturbing for Simon. What is he going to do with it? How's he going to handle it? What's he going to say? Is he going to ask somebody to carry them out? How's he going to respond to this? So I'm thinking to me it might be an intrusion almost like if someone walked in here and they had the Ebola virus and we would be wondering, well, what do we do? How do we handle this? What do we say? What happens if they touch us? I think Simon was feeling some of those same issues. But in the midst of all of that, he also wanted to see how Jesus was going to respond to this situation, how he was going to respond to this woman. So both Simon and this woman have faith. Simon's faith is built on his Pharisaism. It's built on his moralism. It's built on his separatism. It's built on his desire to keep the law. And so what he has faith in is not a God who can save him, but he has faith in what he can do and how well he can keep the law. And one of the ways that he would keep the law is to keep people that were impure, at least people that they thought were impure, away from him and away from them. That was one of the ways they could stay pure and stay right before God. So this moralism cultivated a judgmental attitude for Simon and other Pharisees. It was easy at that point to look down on other people and say, I don't want to have anything to do with you. God must not be favoring you. I want to keep my distance from you. So it's that kind of judgmental attitude. So he sincerely judged the woman, even though he was sincerely wrong, without any recognition that he himself was a sinner. And at the end of the day, that's going to be the issue that Jesus has with Simon more than anything else. His lack of recognition of where he stands before God. On the other hand, this woman had experienced the grace of God in her life. And it was not because she loved. Some will read this text, particularly verse 47, and from that they will gather that somehow because she loved, she was forgiven. Jesus says in this particular text, therefore I tell you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But if you go back and you actually look at the grammar here, it's a perfect tense. And so what it means, what Jesus is trying to say is she has been forgiven and she is continuing to be forgiven. It's just like today, Pastor George said, we need salvation. We need the gospel today. We need it every day. We can't survive a day without the salvation of the Lord. And what Jesus is saying is that this woman, in fact, has been saved. She is not saved because she loved. She loves because she has been saved. Because she has been forgiven her sins. That's why she loves. And that's a great lesson and a great story for us. She loved because she had been loved. And once she felt this love and saw the one who loved her, she experienced a freedom that only true forgiveness can offer. How do you act when you experience that forgiveness? How do you act when you experience that freedom? There's a demonstration of affection toward the source of that freedom. And in this case, the source of that freedom is Jesus. And so when she sees Jesus at this meal with Simon, she can't help herself. It's like there's no one else in the room. It's like it's just her and Jesus. Now, I've got to tell you, I long so many times for that kind of freedom in Jesus. To not care that you're all sitting out here, but that I'm focused just on pleasing God. But like Simon and many others, it is important that you're sitting out here. And too often, I want to please. But she had owned for herself this freedom in the forgiveness that she found in God. And it just freed her up. Freed her up to be who she wanted to be to Jesus himself. She's not trying to get attention, but she is showing an amazing degree of intimacy with Jesus. The only place you would let down your hair in that culture was in the bedroom. In this meal, she lets down her hair and wipes the feet of Jesus. She anoints his feet. She's weeping, not because she's sad, but because she has joy overflowing in her heart. Part of what I love about this story is the reaction of Simon and Jesus. Simon, as the host, is mortified by her behavior. Everything in him screams, "Stop it! Get out!" But he waits to see how Jesus will respond. And so what Jesus does is he reinterprets her actions and sees her as the one who is actually being hospitable to him. Simon is supposed to be the host, but he's really not acting like a host, is he? When you read the story. But she's the one that's the host. She's the one that's receiving with hospitality Jesus. Simon, on the other hand, sees Jesus' tolerance as a sure sign that he is not a prophet. A sure sign that he is not a prophet. Never mind that in a previous story in chapter 7, Jesus heals the centurion's son, raises the woman's son from the dead, and the people say, surely he must be a prophet. Someone who can raise the dead surely must be a prophet. But here Simon is saying, he is no prophet. He sees this woman, he knows what she's like, she's touching him, he understands the laws of our faith, and he is no prophet. And Jesus says this amazing sentence. He says, Simon, I have something to say to you. Now, I know what it would be like if someone said that to me. Simon, I have something to say to you. Mike, I have something to say to you. I think it's going to be important and it may not be all that great. And Simon says, okay, say it. And then Jesus gives him this parable. A certain money lender had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii, the other 50. When they could not pay, he canceled the debt of both. Now which of them will love him more? Just two verses, just short little parable. But it's stinging to Simon. And it may be stinging to you. It is to me. This is not a parable about economics. This is a parable about sin and the debt of sin. It's about the mountain of God's grace that cries out to us for gratitude and love from those who see their sin and have faith to ask God to forgive them. My favorite verse in the story shows up in verse 44, where Jesus, he turns to the woman to talk to the woman or to look at the woman, and he speaks to Simon. So he's talking to Simon and he turns to the woman, but he's still talking to Simon. He says, "Do you see this woman?" Well, of course he sees the woman. That's not what Jesus is asking. He's asking, "Do you see the woman? Do you see her heart? Do you see what's really going on?" And by extension, I think he's saying to Simon, "Do you see your own heart in this? In the way you're treating her?" Clearly, he does see her. He sees her reputation. That's what he sees. He sees what she has done and how it makes him look to others. But Jesus is asking a different question, because Jesus sees her brokenness. And he saw the brokenness in Simon. And the brokenness in Simon was that Simon was unwilling to acknowledge his own sin. That's his brokenness. That's the brokenness of moralists. That's the brokenness of Pharisees. I can't see my own sin. I don't even know that I need to ask God for forgiveness. Simon didn't believe he needed forgiveness because he didn't understand his need. Sure, the woman's heart was revealed in her actions toward Jesus, but Simon's heart was equally revealed in his reaction to her and to Jesus. And frankly, Jesus was more concerned about what he saw in Simon's heart than he was in her heart. Luke is telling us in this parable that God's jubilee has begun in Jesus. You know the story of the jubilee. When all of the debts are removed and forgiven, and freedom comes, forgiveness comes. And one of the things that Luke is trying to say to us is, because Jesus has come, because he's on the scene, that jubilee has begun. God has begun a process of removing all of the debts. And forgiveness is flowing freely to those who will receive it. In other words, here is the grace and the goodness of God. None of us fit in the lesser debt category. Jesus tells this parable and he says, "One owed 50, one owed 500. Brothers and sisters, I'm sorry, but none of us are in the 50 category. We're all in the 500. We all stand before God in need of his grace because we are debtors, big debtors. We're all debtors and stand before God equally deserving. And yet the host of this meal tonight is showing hospitality. The woman understood and Simon did not. That was Jesus. I mentioned earlier this freedom that the woman experienced through forgiveness. One of my all-time favorite movies is The Mission. And if you've seen The Mission or know the story of The Mission, it takes place in the 18th century. It's in South America, and there is a drive by the Spanish and the Portuguese to settle the area, to make a lot of money, to create a lot of trade, and to do that, they needed slaves. They needed South American natives, and to enslave them to do the work for them. And so there was a mercenary in the movie, played by Robert De Niro, named Mendoza. Now, Mendoza was a pretty ruthless guy. He was narcissistic. It was all about him, and he did his job. He did it well. He came back to town one day from a trip gathering slaves, found out that his mistress had a relationship with his brother. Well, he went into this rage, and he killed his brother. And when he killed his brother, something snapped and broke in him. And he went into the kind of depression that Pastor George was speaking about this morning in Haggai 2. He despaired for his life. He despaired everything. He didn't want to eat. He didn't want anything to do with anybody. He just wanted to die. And there was this Jesuit priest who would come and make contact with him and would share with him Finally, he convinced him to go with him up into the jungle, up above the waterfalls to where the natives were, to spend time at a mission that they had developed over there. And he decided to do that. And he said to him, he said, now you're going to have to decide what your penance is. And what he did was he took his breastplate and all of the armor that he had, his scabbard, his sword, he put it all in this big sack and he carried it. It was heavy. And he was laboring. He was laboring to go up these huge, beautiful falls. I'd love to go there someday. But he would go up a certain distance and then he would slide in the mud. He would slide down. He had mud all over him. He was filthy. It was raining. It was just nasty. And some of the other missionaries wanted to help him. And the Jesuit priest wouldn't. He said, no, no. He needs to go this journey alone. He finally got to the top of the mountain. And at the top of the mountain were some of the members that he had captured and some of the family members of those who had been killed and who had been sold into slavery right there. And one of the chiefs took his knife out. And you probably thought right then that Mendoza was going to pay with his life. And what this man did was he took that rope and he cut it. And that big sack of all that Mendoza was carrying with him was released from him and fell off and fell down the falls. And as Mendoza processed that, he just lost himself and he just started weeping. And these were not tears of sadness. They were tears of joy that finally he had been released from the burden that he had carried, the pain that he had carried, and what he had allowed and caused others to suffer was gone from him. Now, thank goodness you and I today don't have to pay penance. But there is one who has come for us, who has done that very work for us. Whether we realize it or not, whether you realize it or not, tonight, many of us have a big sack of our life's troubles, of our life's difficulties, of our life's sins that we're carrying around. And we need to get rid of those. And we haven't realized just yet. We may have been in church all of our life and we haven't realized that Jesus has cut the rope. That through faith in Him, He has released us from the burden of our sin, from the power of that sin in our life, and from that sin itself. There were four words that I wanted to look at tonight. You probably thought they were faith, action, gratitude, and peace. And Jesus says at the very end of this passage, go in peace. That's what happens to people who have that rope cut, who are released from the bondage of their sin. That rope is cut and they're free. They're free to be all that God intended for them to be. But those are not the four words that I'm talking about that will change your life. These are the four words that will change your life. Jesus said, your sins are forgiven. Your sins are forgiven. And because of that, you and I can love Jesus with all of our heart and with all of our soul. When we come to this table tonight, it's not an accident. As I was preparing, it's not an accident that this parable tonight is in the context of a meal. And we're coming right here to have a meal and to celebrate what Jesus has done for us. That He has cut that rope. He has released that bag of all of our garbage. And it doesn't matter tonight. You may be a Simon. You may be a Pharisee. You may actually think, there's not much in my life that I need to ask God to forgive me for. You may be like the woman. You may have some notorious sins. It doesn't matter. We're all the same debtors before God. And Jesus comes to free us from that, no matter who we are. So as you come to this table tonight, my hope for you and for me is that we will actually comprehend the depth of that love that he has for us, that he's cut it away. He's cut our sin away from us so that we can have freedom and fellowship in the Father and understand anew and afresh how much God loves us. Let's pray. Father, we thank you tonight for this amazing story. We thank you, Father, that Jesus, in two short verses, can cut right to the quick. That arrow can pierce our heart tonight. If we're Simon or if we're the woman, no matter who we are, if we're the guests that are sitting around the table, that word, the truth of the gospel, the potential for the forgiveness and freedom that comes with faith in Jesus Christ, that can pierce our heart tonight and set us free. God, I pray that you would do that, that this meal that we're about to receive would be an evidence of your love for us and our love for you. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. Is a visible sign of that great love that Jesus has showered on us in the cross. I can't help the image that just continues to pour into my mind and my heart tonight, that he has set me free and he has set you free. If you believe in Jesus Christ and you have cast your burdens on him, he has set you free tonight. Yes, there may be consequences to your sin. There always is. But he has set you free from the power of that sin in your life. And if he has made you free, you are free indeed. And this table is a testament to that work of God in our lives. I just want to encourage you tonight, if you haven't made that step, if you haven't done what that woman did that night at that meal, then this table, this meal is not for you right now. Your business is with Jesus. Your business is coming to him in faith and saying, God, I need you. I'm carrying these burdens. I've been carrying them too long. I understand that you have come to set me free from those. I want to put my faith, my trust, my hope, my love in you tonight. And he will do that. For others of us, we may be Simons and we may be really good Simons. But we want to recognize tonight that Jesus has died for our sins. And our sins are no different than that woman's sins. Or you may be tonight feeling like, I don't deserve to come to this table. Well, that's true. That's true. You don't deserve. But you're not coming on whether or not you deserve it. You're coming based on what Christ has done for you. And in that, you can rest assured that he will meet you right here at this table. Let me pray and ask God to set apart these elements. Father, we thank you that you are meeting us here tonight in this place, this local expression of your church. Lord, we know that there is nothing magical in this juice and in this bread. But we do believe that you're here and that by the power of your Holy Spirit, as we put our faith and trust in you, you will use this meal to strengthen us in our resolve to keep from sinning, but also in our freedom that we now have in you. So thank you for doing that great work on the cross through your Son, Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. Was handed over to suffering and shame. He took bread. And when he had given thanks to the Father, he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and he said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks to the Father, he gave it to them and he said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. He who eats of me shall never hunger, and he who drinks my blood will never thirst again. This is the body of Christ broken for you.
On the night that he was betrayed, Jesus took the cup in the same way they took the bread. And he said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. This as you, as God's people, this is the blood that has purchased you, that is of greater worth than silver or gold, that declares that you are forgiven. Take and drink.
Thank you.
For those of you who walk in the light of the gospel, your Father says to you, this is the blood of Jesus, my Son, which purifies you from all sin. Take and drink.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you for all that this table means to us here tonight. Your love for us, your forgiveness of our sins, for your great grace and goodness to us. And we are refreshed tonight. We thank you, Father, for the freedom that you have given us to be your children and to serve you and to serve one another in this place, hoping to make a difference in your kingdom, in this community and around the world. Thank you for that privilege that you give us tonight in Jesus Christ. Amen. Do you now stand for his benediction? Raise your hands. Now may the peace of God, which brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. Go in his peace, go in his freedom, go in the love that he has showered on you in Jesus. Amen.